And I work as an UI engineer in the customer experience team in Flipkart.com. So getting into the talk, let's talk about JavaScript. Among us, we know that JavaScript operates on a single call stack. What does this mean? This means that if a function is occupying the call stack currently, your execution is blocked. But we need JavaScript, at least in the front end, to do a lot of things. You need it to listen to events. You need it to listen to, you need it to listen to server calls or WebSocket events. You need to make HTML mutations and so on. But some of these functionalities for JavaScript cannot be synchronous, and so we have async tasks. So what do async tasks do? Async tasks have a register and event listener on an event, or register callbacks on the return of data sources. And these callbacks get executed whenever the event happens. This, for doing this, callbacks are very integral to what JavaScript has been doing. But if you are writing a reasonably large application, you will see that callbacks are have their own problems. If they're unstructured, if you are like injecting anonymous functions into your callbacks, so then your code complexity increases as your functionality increases. And also, since it is not that maintainable, you will not be able to reuse this code across your application. So what can be done about this? Let's first see an example of a callback. So I think this kind of code is every one of us would have written at some point or the other. So we have an AJAX call, a jQuery AJAX. It'll make a server call to that API. I want my application to know that the server call has completed successfully. And so I have that isLoaded variable. So this is fine. Let's look at another example. So what if you had to make two server calls simultaneously, and the state of your UI depended on both of them executing successfully? So to do such a straightforward thing, you will have to maintain three different variables and do unnecessary computation inside each of your callbacks. And this is only with the success. I have not even handled error here. So how do we manage this? Promises. Promises you an object, which it gives you as a result of your async computation. So you don't have to bother if that async call was completed or not. You have your promise, and you can pass it around like an object inside your application. But again, if you are writing, and then you will have a then function inside it. You will pass a callback for success, and you will pass a callback for error. So but again, if you're writing a real-world application, you have some problems, right? A promise executes only once. And as soon as it is executed, it is done with what it has to do. It is not cancelable. There is no concept of canceling a promise once. So the promise resolves. You'll have to do something with the data. You may have to write an if condition to ignore it if you don't want it. You may have to write some complex stuff to get the latest promise out of all the calls that you made. And event listeners don't have promises, right? So that's a tweet from the guy who's working on Rx. He says that bringing promises is like bringing a knife to a gunfight, which I think it is pretty funny. Promises is almost there. It has all the functionality that is required to handle asynchrony, but there's just some little bit missing. So we'll fill this gap and look at what RxJS provides. Over the course of the next 20 minutes, I'd like to show you what constitutes this library, what is inside it, what are the APIs, what advantages should you even use it, and what advantages does it give you if you use it, and how can you start using it right away. It's a pretty small library. You can just include it and start using. RxJS is an offshoot of this project of reactive extensions. So long back in 2011, when .NET was being used to create UI, so they had Microsoft faced the same problems with handling asynchrony and UI callbacks and stuff. And so they wrote something called reactive extensions. This got a bit popular, and there are like now reactive extensions for all these languages, Java, Python, and all of them, and one for JavaScript as well. So reactive extensions, that's the history. Reactive extensions provide you with an API for this entity called observables. So observables are somewhat like a data producer. You can look at them like a collection which produce data as time goes by. So as your so if you model your asynchronous activity inside an observable, it keeps on calling your callbacks every time the activity is completed over time. So if you make a bunch of asynchronous calls, then you so if you have a mouse click event, you get it whenever it happens. And you can manipulate this observable to do things in a more functional way. So observables actually model this data structure called streams. Streams is usually available in many functional programming, pure functional programming languages. So stream is can be considered as an array of an infinite length, and each value in the stream is lazily evaluated. So using this concept, an observable can model all your events, your data requests, your animations, and so on and so forth. And for front-end, at least, these are the main things that we need to do. What reactive extensions does is basically combine two design patterns of the observer pattern and the iterator pattern. If you have read the Gang of Four, let's go on that definition only. So in the observer pattern, you have basically a Let me try if this works. So you have basically a producer, which gives out, which makes some calls in the backend, and it gives out spits out some data, which can be consumed by multiple subscribers. So what this observable will do is it will call an on next if it has good data. It will call an on error if it has some failures. And it will call, most importantly, it will call on completed when it has finished all the possible executions that were possible inside that observable. And also the fact that an observable gives out data one by one in the and you can treat it as a collection implements the iterator pattern. So let's see how we can create an observable out of any activity that you want to do, any kind of computation that you want to do, you can embed it inside an observable. Let's see how you can do that. So you can convert a basic array into an observable using the from method. So if I say rx.observable.from of an array of strings, so this whole expression gives me an observable. You can create an observable from promises themselves, from jQuery promises, say by using from promise. So here I have a search method that in which I have an AJAX call to search Wikipedia with the string query that is input to it, and then it returns an observable form of that promise. You can even create your own custom observable. Like so RX provides you with the create method, which takes an instance of the subscriber. And if some conditions are true inside it, say your AJAX call succeeded or your mouse click was done, it will call the onNext function that has to be implemented as a callback. Next, if an error occurs within this try catch, it will call your onError, just like the diagram I showed. And once it has finished all its computation, it will call the onCompleted method. An interesting part of this is that an observable.create will always return a dispose function. This effectively means that an observable encompasses its own creation and its own destruction methods. So dispose function should ideally have, should clear out any state that the observable has created within this method. So we have an API for observables. Now you need to be able to subscribe to these observables somehow. The API that RX provides is a simple subscribe, or you can even use for each. So in this example, I have a simple observable from an array What this observable does is it gives me the values of each of these strings one by one. Once I subscribe to this array, I'll be receiving those values within inside this. Okay, so the subscribe function takes the gives an onNext function, an onError function, and an onCompleted function. And inside each of these functions, it does whatever side effects it needs to do on that particular state of the value. So in this case, any value, there will be an error. So any value that comes, go into this first function. My side effect here is a console.log. It could be any HTML that I want to change, or any view that I want to change. So now my output for this will be the first one, the second string, the third string, and then I have, then the observable sends me a done method. A done can be logged here. So we can subscribe to the observable. So where is the functional part of it? So we have a set of combinators available in the library which allow you to do all these and more transformations on your observable. So I told you before that you can treat your observable like a collection, right? On a normal JavaScript collection, that is an array, you can have map, filter, and libraries like underscore and others provide many functions that look like this. So similarly, on your observable, you can do your map and filter, which will work in the same manner. It will map it to a new value. And it will always return a new observable. Each of these will always return a new observable and not mutate the existing one. You have methods like flat map, concat map, then what else? Merge and zip, which like combine observables to form another one. You have stuff like skip, take until, reduce, throttle, and stuff, which change the existing observable and create a new one, which transform it or transduce it and create a new one. So we'll see how to use these combinators as we go forth. So those are the four bare bones of what RxJS is. It has a concept for reactive extensions. There's a whole, so it's a tried and tested concept, and there is the architecture of how streams work and all of this. There is an API to create an observable. There is a way to subscribe to the observable, and there are combinators that you can use on an observable to mutate it before even subscribing to it. Let's take a deep breath. Everything is a stream. So when you're writing any Rx code, remember that everything is a stream and everything comes over a period of time. And if you want to go through this again, this will be important when I show code in the future. Okay, so the second item on the agenda is that why do you need to even use it? Is it any good at all? Let's jump into an example where I am making a simple AJAX request using Rx observables. So here, let me open the JS file. So to explain the code here, again, what I want to do is show you that is have a set of queries. So I have this list of queries. What I want to do is for every list, I want to search Wikipedia, get a search result, and get a subset of that search result, and somehow convert it into a string that I can log here. So what do? I have queries. I have a set of queries, which is just a list of strings. I create an observable out of these queries as my starting point. So on this observable, I flat map it over the method search Wikipedia that we defined earlier, the promise one. So what does flat map do? Flat map basically maps every value in this string list into the promise observable, and it creates a map or it creates an array of each of the promises that come out of this and smushes them all together to form one single observable. So at the end of this, you have one single promise observable stream coming out. Now that you have promise observables here, when they resolve, they will send a search result into this map function. So now I have the search result here, and I pull out some subset of the result that I need. So by this time, you have a stream of search results coming to you. What I do next is I zip it along with the original queries and pass it a function which will give me every value of the original query along with the associated value from the previous observable, and then I concatenate the strings to form a suitable response. So what zip basically does is it combines two or more observables and then zips them together. It makes pairs out of them and provides them to this function. So all my computations are done here, and my subscriber has to only do the side effect of console.logging the value. Let's look if the JS will. I guess I can't show you how it works. Okay. Moving on, do you have any questions on this? Very silent. Okay. So, observables give you the reactive part of coding in JavaScript. The combinators on the observables give you the functional part of doing this. So, when you create an observables, you are lazy evaluating. So, on subscribe, all this reacts immediately. Then you use your combinators, which are flat map, zip, and so on, which are functional in their nature. So let's look at some of the combinators that we will be using. This is a visualization RX Marbles. There is a website. You can see these will be interactable on that. I tried to embed it with an iframe, but it wasn't looking good. So this visualization basically shows a source stream going along here and what generated new stream out of this map. So this source stream has these values 1, 2, 3 and they and you can map over them and in this method it is multiplying it by 10. So for every value in the source stream you will get a corresponding value here with the map applied on it. You have a delay function. This basically sets a delay on the whole stream. So the whole stream is shifted. So whatever, you can actually give it a time. Say I say delay by 500 milliseconds. You can shift the whole stream by 500 milliseconds. And delay will maintain the differences in time between each of the values in the observable. Debounce. So debounce basically waits for a certain amount of time before it says I have a value. So if I say debounce for 500 milliseconds, it will wait. After a value, it will wait for 500 milliseconds, give me an object. After this, within 500 milliseconds, it got another value. So it waits again and again until 500 milliseconds pass and it gets another value here. These methods are useful things that you do with time, which if you are working on imperatively, they're pretty hard to do. You'll be passing around a set of set timeouts, set intervals, and trying to clear them at different points of time. The library provides this to you out of the box in a functional manner. So let's look at another example. So the autocomplete widget is like the holy grail example of RxJS. So if you see any article on Rx, it'll have an autocomplete widget. Any article on streams, it'll have one. So why is it such a good example? It basically does a lot of complex stuff in very few lines of code, and I feel JavaScript developers would have at some point or the other implemented an autocomplete widget from scratch or at least from a library and faced problems with it. So I at least did. So here, what I want to do is I have a text input. On this text input, for every key press, I want to call For every relevant key press, I want to call search Wikipedia again. Search Wikipedia. So what all do I do to make this a good experience for the user? So I have my text input. So I can use from event, which is another helper that Rx provides, to listen to the key up events and convert it into an observable. Now I can map over all these key up events and get the value or the text value that the user has input. So here I get a map of all the text values that has been put into the input box. Now what I do here is, so if the length of the string is less than 2, then it doesn't make sense for me to make a server call. So I'd rather filter it out. So here I have a filter which takes away any value that is of length lesser than 2. So by the time you come here, you have a stream of strings which give you text of length greater than 2. I have a debounce method here where I have debounce for 750 milliseconds. So this basically, so if the user is typing really fast or pressing enter a lot of times, this helps you not make those unnecessary server calls. Distinct until changed, it is unless the value that is coming in this stream is a new one which is different to the previous one, it'll not pass it into the next method. The last one that I do is, now that I have my ideal stream of text values, the last thing that I do is I flat map latest over to the search Wikipedia method, search Wikipedia stream that I had created earlier. So what flat map latest does? We learned what flat map does. Flat map latest just ensures that you are getting the newest observable possible. So AJAX calls are finicky, right? If your network network speed varies, you'll have different AJAX calls returning at different times. So when the user types, say, 3 letters and you make a call, and for 4 letters you make another call, you might get the second call before the first call. This might lead to some inconsistencies in your data, inconsistencies in your search in your autocomplete dropdown. You don't want that, and this mitigates it. So once we have our source ready, we can subscribe to it. And this data, this subscribe onNext method only needs to do the side effects, that it shows whatever you need to show on your HTML page. Good, right? Okay. So yeah, autocomplete is hard. I struggled for a long time. Like, I couldn't find a jQuery plugin that does exactly what I want to do. And then to apply a debounce on it, I had to put so many set timeouts and then clear them at every point in time. This definitely made it easier. My last example for this library is one purely on the front end. So what I want to do here is show you an implementation of Mousa, of drag and drop, and show you that it is more intuitive to understand, though not to write, there is a learning curve, but it is more intuitive to understand, and it provides you with all the teardown and the creation that you need to do at every point here. So let's go through this. Say I have an element called drag target, an element, a div, whose ID is drag target. So I pick up the jQuery instance of that. I have a mouse-up event. I create an observable of mouse-up events. This example also kind of shows how you can compose many observables together. Then I have an observable on the mouse-move event. And now I start to create one on mouse-down. So mouse-down is the point where my drag starts. So as soon as I do a mouse-down, I map over the events that come out of mouse-down. And I basically, in this map, I return a stream of an off position objects which have left and top positions. I'll do whatever computation I need here. Now I have my mouse down event ready. Now for the mouse drag event. So mouse drag stream is a combination of mouse down. Whenever a mouse down occurs, you flat map over your mouse move event, get the new positions, and you stop your mouse move event using whenever the mouse up happens, right? This is how drag works. So when you click on an object, you start your drag and you want to move the object to wherever, and when you click out of it, you stop your movement. So this has another unique advantage, that this mouse move does not get triggered unless a mouse down is triggered, and a mouse up, and as soon as a mouse up is done, your mouse moves are disposed of. So yeah, I found this harder to do when I'm writing imperatively. I have an example, I can show it to you later. So now that I have my mouse drag event stream ready, I subscribe on it, and all I have to do is change the position of the drag target. So this is one example of how you can compose your observables together. So I have many observables working here, And an example of how it takes care of creating and destroying itself. So it's that's pretty useful. So on our agenda, we move on to how you can use this RxJS library right away. So in these examples, in these previous examples, I implemented them in JS bin also. And all I had to do was include the rx.all library. So if you're using a vanilla JS project, a small project, or something that includes jQuery, or even something on the backend with Node.js, then all you have to do is include rx.star.js. I say star because there are many versions, depending on what combinators you want in your application. So you have rx.all, rx.light, and so on. So for jQuery support, special support, you have rx.jQuery. So this basically provides you with methods like on as observable here. So you just take your jQuery object and observe over whatever events you want to. Also, Rx has, so once you've included this, you use either of these methods to create a new observable. And then once you have a new observable, all you have to do is start working on it using the combinators. So what if you're using a framework, right? Your MVStar framework. There is good support from Rx for your framework. So for React, it basically gives some mixins and I'm not sure, a parent component or something like that, using which you can watch variables and create observables for any backend calls. So I'm not an expert at React. You have Rx Ember. Rx Ember basically gives you a way to bind your components and watch values as they come. And you can create computed variables using Rx Ember, which basically bind every new value to the view. You have an Rx Angular. So in Angular, the pane is $watts, right? So Rx Angular, what implementations I have seen take care of this creation of watch listeners and destruction of them. Other than these three, there is a project called CycleJS. So what CycleJS provides you with is a framework or a structure to write all your Rx code. And it also has embedded within it support for virtual DOM. So you have all your functional things going on, and every side effect will be propagated through the VDOM. Some more concepts inside RxJS. Yeah, I told you the four, but there are other more complex stuff inside it. So there is a concept of hot and cold observables. This basically allows you to decide when the observables should start giving the subscriber data. Should it give it data even if the subscription is closed, and so on. There is a concept of back pressure. So back pressure is really the way we handle things when an event gives you more data than you can handle. So in case of our autocomplete, we had a case where if the user typed really fast or if he pressed enter really fast, you don't want to handle those things. So you have stuff like your throttle and debounce, which do back pressure for you. Also, if you don't want, so throttle and debounce, basically you lose certain events in between, right? So if you don't want to lose those events, Rx provides you with a buffer kind of a thing where you can put things in the buffer, but that too has its limitations because if the data source is emitting continuously, your buffer also gets filled up. There are some more APIs within Rx so that you can write better structured code. There is something called Rx Subject and Rx Schedulers and Timers, which allow you to do various different things inside that. So say I had to wait after a mouse down to determine whether it was a click or a drag event, then I would use a timer to keep that distance. So key takeaways, what I want you to understand from this talk is that declarative programming is a much more better paradigm for what we do in JavaScript. So as the days goes by, we have new things coming inside. We have HTML5 APIs, we have web workers. All of these work on some kind of message passing system. it will get harder to manage as your code base grows. So writing declaratively will definitely be a win. So that means automatically you have your side effects localized to only some places. So in Rx, you have your side effects localized to only the subscriber. Error handling becomes smoother. So in my autocomplete example, if you wherever I would get an error, that would get propagated to the subscriber directly. It is more composable. You can call functions one over the other. And streams. Streams are awesome. I feel writing this way leads to more robust code. One, because this reactive extensions is a tried and tested method. From a long time, people have been working on it. And they have also made it browser compatible all the way up to IE6, though I have not tried it. And they do work on performance, though I don't have benchmarks. They do work on performance, and they want to be better than the other FRP libraries out there. So what are the other FRP libraries out there? So the picking is small, but it is... So I've not used all of these. I've used Bacon.js. I've read what is Kefir.js. So Bacon.js is basically something that was inspired out of Rx. So the author couldn't wrap his head around what hot and cold observables are. So he created two kinds of streams called event stream and properties. And Bacon.js is basically a much friendlier library. It is smaller, and the documentation was better until up to a few months ago. But it is not a very performant library. So what the people at Kefir.js want to do is that they want to take the concepts from both of these and make it a very performant library to make to write FRP. FRP meaning functional reactive programming. Then you have various other libraries which are trying to do the same thing. All these are linked in my slides. I'll share them later. So who uses this, right? So the people I know who use it in production are, I use it for a very small, I had to write a search console, and I used this for the first time. Netflix uses it extensively. They are evangelists of this library, and they have open sourced a library called Hystrix with the Rx Java, which is being used like pretty much everywhere where people want to do simultaneous calls to aggregate data or something like that. Asana are big propagators of reactive programming, though I don't know if they're using Rx at all. So resources. So after this, please go try at least writing one observable in this. And you can use either of these things to learn more about it. You have Egghead.io videos, which are really good. They're short videos explaining each concept in Rx. You have LearnRx, which is a... So I showed you in the tweet, right? Which is a tool by Jafar Hussain. He works at Netflix. So what LearnRx provides you with, it provides you with a REPL kind of a web page where as he goes on introducing concepts, you have to solve problems. It's really useful, though very basic. Then there's this awesome talk by him explaining what, I mean, it should have been a precursor to this talk, but now if you go watch it, it'll make more sense. And he explains it much better than I do. That's it. I am open to questions. I hope you get distracted by that.
Hi. Did you try migrating an legacy JS code to RxJS library, and what was your experience if so?
So not a complete migration. I did not help. I saw a friend of mine do this for Node code. It doesn't really reduce the lines of code as you would expect, but definitely it becomes much more reasonable. So random stuff like you were having a for loop with like which goes from 0 to 16 and fills some data. So all this stuff became more functional, and adding new features to this also became a little bit easier. So as time goes, you will see whether other developers also find it easy. Yes.
And this library is from, is it from the Microsoft team, the RX?
So yes. Microsoft originally started the Reactive Extensions project. This library is very supported by Netflix right now, but it's open source.
Thank you.
Hi. So how expensive is it to add an...
I can't see.
Yeah.
Okay.
So how expensive is it to add an observable to an object, as opposed to adding a watch on the same object, the native watch call?
Native watch.
Yeah.
So what do you want to do with the native, I mean?
So given the fact that if my side effect is pretty simple as just doing a console.log,
mm-hmm.
So is it advantageous to use this over
watch? Major advantage of using the library is the composability that it provides, right? So it basically allows you to do a lot of computation beforehand. So what I wanted to show with the JS bin earlier was that until a subscriber comes to this, none of the code in that source observable will be executed. So only when a subscriber is added to it, all that gets executed. So you could call it lazy. So every time there is a subscriber, only then it will get. So this advantage, I feel, would be better using this library.
Okay. But internally, it would be the same concept as a watch, right?
Yes, it would be. My basically USP for this library is that it makes your code more maintainable. And when you are developing something along with a large number of developers, it makes it easy to communicate certain things for anybody to work on the code base. That's what I feel, my opinion.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm here.
Okay.
So very interesting library you mentioned. My question is, in the beginning you mentioned about problems associated with nested callbacks,
mm-hmm.
and RxJS solves this problem very elegantly.
Mm-hmm.
So how does it solve the problem? I mean, is it in a way similar to how other libraries out there solve this very problem, like async, for example?
So nested callbacks meaning you are having two different data sources. You want to call one inside the other. So Rx kind of solves it using the flat map method. So you can combine various observables to form, so basically nested callbacks means you have, say, an AJAX call, you get some data out of it, you have another AJAX call dependent on it, you get some more data out of it, and you, in the end, you want to work on the data of the second AJAX call, right? So such kind of thing can be done by composing two different observables. So you have two data sources, you can compose them together and subscribe to this as a whole in the end. So that is the elegant solution I was talking about.
And one more. So this is meant only for AJAX calls, or it could be used for any other blocks of code which have like
it
this
is.
Callback?
So the method that I showed where you can create an observable on your own. So in that you can put, so in this method you can basically put any async thing that you want to do, have a success callback inside it, and then project it as an observable. So WebSockets, event listeners, your iframe messages, all of these can be put in.
Thank you.
Hey. Nice presentation and nice images. My question is not particular to RxJS, but on the abstract level, so we have this observed pattern, right? So how does it compare with the publisher-subscriber model?
So the publisher-subscriber only implements the observer pattern. You don't have your iterator inside it. So you don't get the, at least in my in the context of my talk, you do not get the advantages that you do with using a stream data structure in a PubSub model.
Basically, you are saying that this is just implementation of PubSub.
Yes, yes. It is a higher level, highly abstracted implementation of that.
Hi. Here. Okay. Is he right? So, according to the reactive manifesto, this RX. Hello.
Okay.
According to the reactive manifesto, this RxJS covers all the four reactive manifesto things.
Are you asking me? Or So reactive manifesto is a very large document. So I don't know up to whether it implements it to the full extent. Learning whatever in this also was, I was new to functional programming also when I got into this. So no, I haven't really read the full reactive manifesto.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions?
Thanks a lot for having me here.
Folks, please use your new